It is tradition in the Christian church to begin worship with a proclamation of what we are celebrating today. And this is a call and response. I will say, Christ is risen. You will respond, Christ is risen indeed. And we will do that three times. I invite you to stand as we are able. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Let us sing together. Sit, and then we'll sing.
Amen. our confession, where we realize our desire for God and our hope for God's mercy. It is in admitting the truth of our lives that we take the first step toward wholeness and healing. So let us make our confession, confident that our God who hears us is a God who forgives us. Almighty God, in raising Jesus from the grave, you shattered the power of sin and death. We confess that we remain captive to doubt and fear, bound by ways that lead to death. We resist your love, ignore our neighbor indeed, and cling to the values of this broken world. Forgive us out of mercy. Help us to trust your power to change our lives and make us new, that we may know the joy of life abundant. In Jesus Christ, risen Lord. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Friends in Christ, know that you are forgiven and live in peace. Amen.
Invite our children to come forward if you would like to. I'd love to meet you down here. Thank you for coming. Here, you want to sit on the steps maybe? We've got some more. You won't be alone. You guys all look so wonderful. How's your arm?
Good.
You doing all right? Good, good, good. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Very, very proud of you. You did great, though. You did great. So, it's Easter. Have you already had an Easter basket experience this morning? Your moms and dads did good then, right?
Too much candy.
Too much candy, yeah. Is there such a thing? I don't know. I don't think so. I'm so glad. Good morning. Hi, I love your dress. Well, of all the things that we could talk about on Easter, I want to talk about the people whose names are on this yellow piece of paper. It says at the top, Easter flowers in our sanctuary and spring plantings given by, and there's a whole list of people that have given these flowers in memory of, and there's a whole list of people that these folks who gave the flowers are remembering. Because these folks have died, they are with Jesus now, they are enjoying the reward that he promised them, and these folks are remembering them on this special day. What I want us to think about is that it is because of what we celebrate on this day, Jesus being resurrected from the dead, that we believe these people who have died live in heaven with God, with Christ, in the Holy Spirit. They still live. And that they are with us. We believe in our church in what is called the communion of saints. And that includes not only the people here that are living and breathing, that includes all of Jesus's people who have gone to be with him in heaven. They are with us here. So we're not only remembering them, we're welcoming them into our presence because they live forever. And there'll come a time when all of us will live forever. Happy Easter. I'm so glad to see you this morning, and thank you for coming down. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you today for all of those who we remember who have gone to be with you, but whom we trust live even today. And we thank you that in your Spirit they are still with us, that they still that they're still with us. And we thank you that one day we will be with them and with you. Through Christ we pray. Amen. Okay, y'all have a great day.
Let us pray. Almighty God, by your Holy Spirit, illumine the sacred page, we pray, that our minds may be open to receive your word, our hearts taught to love it, and our wills strengthened to obey it. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our scripture reading is from Acts chapter 10, verse 34 through 43. Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right and is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. The message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee and after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of men that slept. Now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. And did he rise? Did he rise here in the nations? Here in all ye dead. He rose, he burst the bars of death. He burst the bars of death. He burst the bars of death and triumphed o'er the grave. Triumphant past the crystal ports of life and seized eternal youth. Man, all immortal, hail, hail, heaven, all lavish of strange gifts to man. Thine's all the glory, man's the boundless bliss. Thine's all the glory, man's the boundless bliss. Triumphant past the crystal ports of light and seized eternal youth. Thine's all the glory, man's the boundless bliss. Thine's all the glory, man's the boundless bliss.
Pastor walked into the Huckleberry, which, as some of you know, is the name of the ice cream store in Montreat. And he was surprised to see a person that he knew way back in seminary. Her name was Miss Ada. At least that's what everybody called her. And he remembered Miss Ada as being sort of an eccentric woman. Though not a student, she never missed a seminary chapel service. She was always intercepting busy professors crossing the quadrangle, asking them complex theological questions. At formal seminary receptions, she would greet visiting dignitaries as if she owned the place. Well, this minister embraced Miss Ada, reintroduced himself, and said, "What brings you to Montreat?" She said, "Well, I haven't been here in decades. But the last time I was here, I worshiped in Anderson Auditorium, and just as the preacher got up to preach, someone handed him a note which he read on the way to the pulpit. 'I've got good news,' he said. 'The war is over. Peace has been declared.'" Then Miss Ada added, "It's been so long since I've heard good news that I just thought I'd come back here and see if I could hear some." Well, friends, today I've got good news, and I am glad that you are here to hear it. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body.
While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified and on the third day rise again?" Then they remembered his words. And returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb, stooping and looking in. He saw the linen cloths themselves. Then he went home, amazed at what had happened. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Sunday of Resurrection, Easter Day, is not only the greatest day in our liturgical year, the highest of our high holy days, it is also the only one that is set by the moon. Because Easter always falls on the first Sunday after the first full moon on or after the spring equinox. Got all that? Now, as complicated as that sounds, it makes perfect sense because it means that Easter coincides with the greening of the earth. For us here in the high country, the bursting of daffodils and hyacinths, forsythia. After a long winter, the earth is waking from its slumber, and with the exception of that pesky yellow-greenish powder that will soon cover everything, we are about to enjoy another beautiful spring. And unless we are very careful, this almost seamless connection between the coming of spring and Easter, between the waking of the earth and the resurrection of Lord, unless we are careful, we might be tempted to think that resurrection is natural. Like sap rising, daffodils blooming. Say you buy a daffodil bulb in the winter. What's it look like? Like a little onion, maybe, with thin skin and scraggly roots. But if you know anything about bulbs, that doesn't bother you. Because you know all you have to do is put it in the ground and wait. Because come springtime, it will escape the earth and explode like a butterfly coming out of its cocoon. Well, as miraculous as that is, it is completely natural. Just as so many of the images we use for Easter are natural, like eggs cracking open, revealing little chicks, like grass coming green, like butterflies crawling out of cocoons, all completely natural. Resurrection, on the other hand, is completely unnatural. And each of the four gospel writers has his own way of saying that. Mark writes that when the women go to the tomb to anoint Jesus' body, they discover the impossible. The giant stone has been rolled away, and a young man dressed in white is sitting just where Jesus' body ought to be. Matthew tells basically the same story, except that he adds that there was this great earthquake as the angel of the Lord appeared and rolled away the stone, and that the guards were so afraid they shook and became like dead men. John tells us that when Mary Magdalene learned that his body was missing, she was so distraught that through her tears she mistook him for the gardener. And that it wasn't until he called her name that he knew her. And finally, when Luke goes to remind us that there is nothing natural about resurrection, he uses a little three-letter word, but. The 23rd chapter of Luke ends with Joseph of Arimathea wrapping up Jesus' dead body and placing it in a tomb. But, begins chapter 24, on the first day of the week at early dawn, the women came to the tomb and the body was not there. They found the stone rolled away, but when they went in, they did not find the body. Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but he is risen. Returning from the tomb, they told this to the 11, but their words seemed like idle tales. Using this defiant little conjunction 6 times in 12 verses, it's as if Luke is trying to stop us in our tracks, grab us by the lapels, give us a good shake, all so we will understand that no matter what we have heard, we have not yet heard all the story. That yes, Joseph of Arimathea may have put a lifeless corpse in that tomb, but on the first day of the week, at early dawn, he was not there. Karl Barth once put it this way, the gospel, he said, is not a natural therefore, but a miraculous nevertheless. And what this means is that though you may walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you need fear no evil. For the Good Shepherd is with you, his rod and his staff will comfort you. It means that with Paul you can be certain that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor anything in all creation will be able to separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. It means that whatever you thought was impossible, the recovery of a child, the healing of a marriage, forgiving someone who hurt you deeply, whatever you thought was impossible is not, because with God all things are possible. Easter means that God reached down into the tomb, lifting Jesus to new life. And it means that God will reach into the places where you and I are dead and dying and do the same for us. So who knew that this little three-letter conjunction could say all that? But it does. God's great, however. Now, Luke was compelled to do this because he knew that there was another storyteller in this world. He had to stop us in our tracks and grab us by the lapels and give us a good shake because he knew that there is one out there who is spreading a completely different narrative that doesn't go past the devastation of Good Friday. It ends this story with what is natural. Death is natural. Grief is natural. Loss is natural. It believes that the way things are the way things will always be. And I know I'm guilty sometimes of believing this alternate story. Maybe you are too. We accept it whenever we say, oh, he'll never change. That's just the way it is. There's really no hope. Some of you who know me know that I've often prided myself in being somewhat of a realist. And sometimes that's a good thing. It helps me be a problem solver. But I also know how realism can quickly turn to cynicism. How easily I can get paralyzed in the face of life's challenges. How quickly I can just become passive, accepting, hopeless. It's at those times I need Luke to remind me of this defiant yet hopeful little conjunction. Tony Campolo tells about the time he attended worship in an African-American church in West Philadelphia. You may have heard this story. It was amazing, Campolo said, because for a full hour and a half, the preacher preached just one line over and over and over again. That line was, "It's Friday, but Sunday's coming." Tony says he started out slowly and softly. It's Friday. It was Friday, and Jesus was dead on a tree. But that was only Friday, and Sunday's coming. It's Friday. Mary was crying her eyes out, and the disciples were running in every direction like a sheep without a shepherd. But that was Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday, and the cynics of the world were saying, the way things have always been, that's the way they will always be. Nothing has changed, but the cynics didn't know that it was Friday, and Sunday's coming. It's Friday, and on Friday, all the forces who oppress the poor and make the weak to suffer were in control, but that was only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday, and on Friday, Pilate thought he had washed his hands of Jesus, and the Romans were strutting around as if they were back in control, but they didn't know it was only Friday, and Sunday's coming. And the preacher just kept on working this same line over and over again. It's Friday, but Sunday's coming. It's Friday, but Sunday's coming. Until at the end of his message, he just shouted out, "It's Friday," and all 500 people shouted in one voice,
"It's Sunday's coming."
Well, my friends, Sunday is here. The tomb is empty. Everything has changed because Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to stand as you are able, and let us sing together hymn number 353, "My Hope is Built on Nothing Less."
Thank you.
I invite you to remain standing and let us say together what we believe on this day. This is the good news which we have received, in which we stand and by which we are saved, if we hold it fast, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day, and that he appeared first to the women, then to Peter, and to the 12, and then to many faithful witnesses. We believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus Christ is the first and the last, the beginning and the end. He is our Lord and our God. Amen. Would you pray as I pray these words? God, it wasn't so long ago that we gathered together in this place to celebrate the birth of Christ and to reflect on the mysteries of your incarnation, the way he emptied himself of divinity, yet at the same time perfectly reflected your image. How he entered the fullness of our humanity with all our joys and all our sorrows, just without all of our sin. Through the muck and the mire, he proclaimed the good news of your love. He showed us how you intend us to be, and he brought hope to the most hopeless of places. In this past week, we have witnessed the worst of humanity, rejecting your gift of hope, putting Christ to death, trying to hinder the emergence of your kingdom in our world. In those dark moments, we recognize the darkness that threatens our lives and our world, loneliness and grief, illness and death, divisions and war, injustice and inequality. We know these realities are not abstractions for so many. It is the common condition of humanity shared even by Christ all the way to the cross and to the grave. But on this day, O God, you have rolled away the stone and your light has pierced the darkness of the tomb. On this day, the hope that Jesus lived and died for has emerged even stronger than before. On this day, O God, Christ's resurrection gives us hope that nothing, no tragedy, no mistake, no sin, no evil is beyond the redemptive power of your love. This is the truth of your kingdom, the kingdom we long for, a kingdom for which we now pray using the words the living Christ teaches us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation. Friends, with joy and thanksgiving, let us bring our gifts to God. Let us pray. Help us to be generous givers, dear Lord, both of our money and of our lives, that we might make a difference in this world you love so much. We ask this through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave all that he was, that we might know life in all its fullness. Amen. Our next hymn is number 246, Christ is Alive. I remind you, if you'd like to come and sing the Hallelujah Chorus, we would love to have you up here. There are copies somewhere back there.
There were.
I think they've already been taken, but you can just lip sync it or something like that.
Or share.
Or share, right. But we would love to have you come forward as we sing hymn number 246, Christ is Alive.
Thank you.
learning a second time from our African-American preacher brothers and sisters. Ted Wardlaw once told of a time when he invited an African-American preacher to lead the sermon during a Good Friday service. And Wardlaw said he loved it because preaching in that style actually loosened some of those Presbyterians up a bit. But what he loved most was what the preacher said after he finished reading the crucifixion story. It was not the usual, "the word of the Lord, thanks be to God." Instead, what he said was, "May God bless you, and may God protect you from the enemy who would try to steal this word from you." Those are words appropriate for every blessing after every reading of Scripture, but perhaps on this day in particular, may God bless you and protect you from the enemy who would try to steal away from you this word of hope. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Amen.
Thank you.